Usually in the presentations I start a little bit messy, and in the development it gets better. I'll try not to be very messy. I'll try. So the presentation, it's called My Breeds, Disobedient Horses, Non-Stop Stop Motion, Steps and Missteps. Okay, Non-Stop Stop Motion is a concept which intends to become a method. Non-Stop Stop Motion investigates where we can find the essence of the magic trick of the cinematography when we look into everyday life and what happens when we use these everyday situations, object spaces, actions, etc., as cinematographic mechanisms. Here we have a visualization of timeline. It's a current visualization, but it's very interesting that the principle that all the current equipment works with exactly the same principle. So they capture single images and then they put it in sequences, and then we display these sequences with different medias, and then we see motion illusion. And it's very fascinating that all these years the principle stays the same. I mean, of course, there are some exceptions. In last week I was reading about that they now try to develop a super, super high speed camera that it records, I don't know, 5 million frames per second, and it tries to get out of the frame idea. But still, let's say that these are very, very experimental things. Still, all these things captured in images. And so I was thinking, okay, we have, we call them frames. And these frames are kind of units. There are kind of fragments that they relate to each other. And so my hypothesis was, let's start imagining that these are not only images, are everything, anything. And then that hypothesis that it could be whatever. Then the question is, what would be the corresponding mechanism that could separate units in such a way that they can also produce an illusion of motion? So what would be the projector? Okay, this is a old fashioned projector for film. Okay, but if it could be you, me, this lamp, whatever, what would be the mechanism, the cinematographic mechanism? And to explain it, yeah. And then I start searching everyday setting, situations, and movements that can function as such mechanisms. So what do they need to be that kind of mechanisms? So in order to explain, I will give one word. Cinematographic mechanism can be everything around that can separate units intermittently. Okay, that's the right word, I think. If I understand well, this word is kind of the opposite of continuous. And then I start searching, and I do lists of possible situations, objects, movements that can separate units intermittently. And okay, I will explain this later. I brought here two objects. So you see this? This is, the weight. And I found it in a store. And this, for example, it could be as such a mechanism that could display two films. Each film could have 6 frames. So imagine that we stick here the frames, 6 here and 6 there. And because they have this price, the paper here, it also can slip. And because it's heavy, when it slips, it fails also in the same point. So if we imagine that this is not a lamp, but it's a camera, and we start filming that thing, we see one film here, one film there. Or even better, I was imagining to hold it in an escalator, like holding like a and turns, yeah. Another object, sometimes it's not only I find objects or situations, I build also some stuff. So this is again a film of 6 frames. It's a cube made out of 8 cubes. And it can display a film out of 6 frames, which is very, very interesting because it changes also the size and the depth of the frame. So again, we imagine this is a camera or our eyes or whatever. And we change 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1. And it's very interesting because it changes the depth here and the size of the film. Yeah. I start making huge collections of lists of these possible things. So stairs, drawers in a stapel, domino fall, breaking something intermittently, which I think every time you break something, you break it, I cannot imagine continuously. Anyway, exploding something intermittently, cutting something. I mean, if I have a scissor and I cut something, I should not cut it continuously, but I should cut 1, 2, 3, and so on. So the first experiment was this one, where I used the staircase and I put apples, gradually eaten apples on the staircase, and then I put the cameras on my shoes and I walk up the stairs, and then I saw if it was a film. It was not really a film coming out, but it was interesting. Quite often, as I said, with, for example, this one or any other thing, it's not that they work as they are. This should be modified. So we say, okay, we have the idea with the drawers and the staple. So I was thinking I could build something like that and turn it. And then every time that it fails, the frames are in the drawers and they fail and they start filming. So I start imagining this kind of structure. If I imagine that I throw the frames in the camera, so I should build something on the camera and so on. And then I start going very much into the mechanism they created, and I should be very, very precise, unfortunately, because it should be really working and letting the things falling exactly in the same thing. And then I build the thing, that's the process, and then I try it out. Yeah, and then I go to the term hyperframe. What are the hyperframes? I will read it and then I will explain it again. Hyperframes are the single units, objects, images, whatever, which form the sequence and cause the illusion of the movement in non-stop stop motion films. I use the term hyperframes in order to differentiate them from the frames that the video camera records. For example, a standard camera records 25 frames per second. Usually, more than one video frames is required to record a hyperframe. Video frames reveal what happens in between the hyperframes and connect the viewer with the actual recorded space and action. Okay, we'll talk about this later. So again, to explain this. So here are my hyperframes, the apples, the images, the things. And this is here in the zoo is the camera. And let's imagine I go up the stairs, I film, and because I'm not so fast as the record or as the camera, then the camera records more frames, video frames, my frames. So my frames are somehow bigger. And because I like the idea of hyper, so it opens also the idea. So I call them hyperframes. It was very, very important to give them a different name because it was very confusing when I was writing texts to differentiate. I was referring to them the frames, and then I was saying, okay, to record the frame, I need 20 frames. And it was starting being very confusing. So, and then going back to hyperframes, Edward Maybridge, you know, the guy who somehow invented the cinema before cameras, actually not alone, but anyway, he was using also hyperframes, and he was using people because they were easy, and he was positioning them in this, and then he was making these photos, and I said, okay, this is very nice, very clever. I want to do the same, but because he has already done it, I want to use also people, but this time I want them, I will use more people. And I will tell them, okay, people perform the 8 frames Maybridge step, and they should be exactly in the same position, the middle of the camera. And, but they were very different people, so they were big and small and fat and not fat, and you know, it was different people. And the question is, could they function as one? Could be somehow unified through the steps? And yeah. So that was the question, and of course we had somehow to do it. I was imagining it could work, but it was nice that it really worked at the end. Yeah. So, what kind of hyperface can its mechanism animate? And then we are coming to the physics. Let's go to the scenario, we are cutting something intermittently. It should be soft and be able to be cutted. If we break something intermittently, it should be breakable. So we have this kind of physics that create the... And then the most important and the most interesting question of all this is what kind of narratives can be displayed. So the thing is that I built the mechanism, and I... In that case, it was plates. It was IKEA chip plates, and I was starting breaking them, and seeing with random images or you know my breeze, whatever. And then I was looking the footage and thinking, what can say this story actually? Why? What is happening? Why someone is breaking something? Why? And and then I came to the idea to create a kind of machine that it works only the moment that is being destroyed. Yeah. And or in the scenario that I'm cutting something, I mean, I refer a little bit again to the pre-cinematic stuff, to Marais, and he was using birds and stuff. And I say, okay, I will use also birds. And this time I will cut their wings and see what happens. The camera comes together with the scissor. Yeah, so you cut it and it fly, and then I go to the technical and physical limitations, which are very, very interesting. So I had the idea to make a video that I use as a mechanism the curtains, and then there were two problems. First, that the image that should be on the curtains, it should be hanged. I couldn't use, for example, a car or something because it's not flying. So it, everything that it should be on this should be kind of hanged. The story should be hanged. And the other problem was even more worse. It was that the camera. I had to face, even if I was using three curtains because the space is big, I had a very, very, very huge problem with perspective. And I said, okay, the story should have also perspective. Then I had the idea to hang the images, and then to create this kind of swing, that somehow the swing has accelerated the perspective, so it wouldn't bother the physical perspective. And of course, I had the window also at the end of the curtain, so it was also a very big. What is happening with the window? What would happen? Would it break the window? Would it jump out of the space? Yeah, at the end, it didn't do anything actually, it stayed inside, blocked. Yeah. And. Then how what is the role of the camera? What is the video documentation is doing to all this? So I will show you this example. So we see this image. We imagine, yes. Okay, again, sorry. So we see this image and we imagine the travel, the window, the reflection in the window, the trains, whatever. And then it appears this image that it's an umbrella and it's static. But if the camera was missing, it would still be very unrelated. So the camera, quite often, it's in the image in order for the audience to relate where this is the eyes of the audience, I would say. Yeah. And what is the relation between the illusion and the action that is causing it? Okay, this question would appear more times. Okay, we saw the stories of conflicts. So I break something and it works. I cut the wings and it flies. And many others, but I don't saw all of them. But I was wondering, okay, that's kind of easy. Could be this non-stop stop motion do also different things, not conflicts, could say different stories. And then I said, okay, I will build a kind of hyperframe that is would be big as me, and hyperframes, and it would be kind of co-protagonist with me. And I did this little. I forgot to say, if you want to interrupt me anytime and ask.
Thank you.
Yeah, and failures. Okay, of course, as I do a lot of videos, a lot of tries and stuff. And of course, what I saw you until now, it's the ones that I suppose they somehow work and or they are kind of okay. But there are the failures. There are three categories of failures. When it doesn't work, we don't see any illusion. Yes. And then half working, which is even worse, that no working is even worse, because here, even if I would speed it up, it wouldn't work. I have two different speeds. And the most sad ones, when they break and they are too expensive and difficult to rebuild them. And the fourth part, which is the worst of all, it's when I rebuild the whole, I don't know, cinema or whatever, in order to animate this. So it's a huge machine around in order to animate nothing, and this could happen, and this is very, very annoying. So you invest your time and your brain to do nothing. So can hyperference lead to unplanned narratives? Okay, that's a kind of new stuff. Until now, I knew. I mean, I was designing these hyperframes. I knew what would be the second, the third one, the fifth one, and I was hoping that it would function. But how I could not know. So this is an experiment will take place in next month, I hope. So it's I am building these mouths, and I will explode them in order to open, but to open in kind of unplanned way. And then I have the second one would be again closed. So I open and closed, but I cannot control how it would be this opening. So I am hoping to create a kind of talk which would be kind of unplanned. The other one thing I was doing here now, it's the active hyperframes. So until now, all the hyperframes, even if they were humans, they were very, very passive. So I was telling them, okay, stay there and I will film you that way and so on. But what would happen if the hyperframes were filming me? So it's not that I was filming the things, but they were somehow taking a more active role. And then I had the idea to make this this construction there, which it's this kind of movement in photos in 10 different photos, and as it comes closer to you, it reflects. It reflects. So the thing is that I was filming them, and it was really great to do this here because I have this big long space. And I was going backwards, like with inside, of course, like, yeah. And I was, and at the end, I was having my selfie here, so somehow. So it was filming me that I was filming it. And then I find out and I realize that because it's opposite, so the direction that it films, the zoom in, it comes to that direction. And actually, even if I was moving that way or that way, camera was going to the different direction. So I was creating a kind of vertigo effect. Vertigo effect, okay, I show you. It's a vertigo film from Hitchcock. Actually, his cameraman invented it for him, and it became very, very famous, which was that second. It was only that second, and they wrote a whole theory about that. And it really changed the whole cinema that second. Which what happens here is we have a kind of zoom out, and zoom out with the camera, so with the lenses, and a dolly which is moves. We can see it in this wall, that it moves in the opposite direction and creates this kind of dizziness. And another example which is more visible, it's the jaw from the jaws. I mean, Lord of the Rings is full of these kind of things. Yeah, that was it. So we have this guy who's locking the shark, eating the child, and we see what is happening. Okay, so with the background, he's coming close, the background goes away. So I was creating a kind of vertigo selfie. Which is not finished. Okay, the sound effects are terrible, change them. But, the nice thing about this thing is that I could change the characters also. You know here? Yeah. And I'm thinking that because right now my mother and my grandmother are landing in Vienna to bring them tomorrow here and turn this vertigo selfie to a kind of time machine. Because I look very much to my grandmother and my mother. So I don't know, maybe it will work, it will be nice. I don't know. Of course, you are asking the digital manipulation because, yes. It's obvious there is, it exists. And I was feeling very, very, very guilty. So I will show you the only two experiments that I didn't manipulate them digitally, which means that the objects could work as they are without the use of a video camera computer. So it was the domino, one of the first things. Which I will accidentally the domino bricks are failing 27 per second, which is very, very close to frame rate, so it could work nice. The other one, which took much more time to develop, it's this trick that I was thinking a faster movement, which is the pendulum, how I could separate it somehow. And it was difficult. It was very simple. Yeah. But difficult. Yes, and actually that's the trick here. So we have a magnifier, paper glasses, and beneath of the paper glass here, I cut with laser cutter the image. And then it's important to put it opposite, to put it upside down, and then you have the pedaling, and when it comes, it appears the image. So, and then I had just to arrange them. Yeah. Which was very simple, very, very simple, but it took some time. Yeah. The other thing, no. Oh, here. Yeah, but what I was telling, yeah, about the digital manipulation. These two examples were without digital manipulation. All the others were with. And I was feeling very, very guilty about that, and I was never talking about that. But it exists, and the thing is, why it exists is like all our movements are much, or the most, are much more slower. Okay, some there are faster, but usually it's much more slower than the speed it needs to separate the frames. So what I was usually doing, it was speeding just up the things. And then I was wondering, okay, but what is the speed of the illusion? How much do I speed something in order to appear in front of my eyes in illusion? And then I start measuring it. And okay, I call this illusional speed. It is the minimum, let's say, the minimum speed that the illusion appears in front of Anna's eyes. And this is, for example, in the humans, it was just 8 hyperframes per second. And the other one, in the machine, it was 17 hyperframes per second. And then I was wondering why this is happening, why does this need? And then I was thinking, yeah, but this movement, we know it already. So it's very obvious what is going to happen here. And this one is much more complex. So then I was thinking, like, yeah, maybe it works like the words. Like when we know one word, we need less time to read it than when we don't know. And then I call, it's another thing about speed, another new word invention, the non-stop stop motion time, which is exactly the opposite of the bullet time. And I will explain immediately what I mean. So, yeah. So we have here in the bullet time. It was a great, very very important invention in 1999 in Matrix, that they wanted really to show these action scenes in a very weird and impressive way somehow. So what they did, we see here Neo moving.
Speed up a bit.
We are late. Okay, sorry. Okay.
Frames.
Let's go back from Neo. Okay. Sorry, Neo. Okay, and the other thing, no, I mean, I will tell this. Okay, bullet time is when we see the camera, it's moving, here the camera moves naturally and Leo moves slow motion. And in my case, the hammer is going fast forward and the gears goes naturally. So it's visible these two speeds. And then we have, and then I did another experiment very recently. I performed the 12 frames from my bridge again, from dancing. And I did it again with different people in order to unify them and dance with a single creature. And then I find something weird was happening. So I have these people coming and perform one step with me. Ta ta ta. And okay. And then I was starting speeding them up. More and more and more and more and more. Starting to creating this. But then when I was speeding more and more and more and more and more and more, then they start disappear. And I stayed alone in the dance. And this happens because, okay, so I will show how it was happening. We had also little news. Yeah, and then he was leaving, okay. living Latium. Okay. And then the question, what is the relation between reality and illusion again? So it's visible, both. And the most important is that we see in one, we see the what happens in between the hyperframes. It's Norman McLaren was talking a lot in his texts about that, that it's very for the animation. He was saying it's much more important what happened in between the frames, the ones that it's not the camera is not really takes photos. In my case, it's visible. It's visible what happens, and this gives the opportunity somehow to see both, to see the reality and to see the illusion at the same time, and somehow to pick what you want to see. And then I was thinking these images, which are the double images, the duck and the rabbit. But after some while, when you know the duck and the rabbit, you see both of them at the same time. Then the researching about these images, I find that Wittgenstein was using them to describe the two ways of seeing. The seeing the things that as it is, so we see that this is straight. But if we put water, we don't see it straight anymore. We see it different. And it's this conflict that we have. When we know that the things are not like that, but we see something different, and this is also very close to the magic. So we know that it's fake, but we still see something. So I was thinking, okay, I really want to create a kind of this conflict, so that we definitely know what we see, but we keep seeing something totally different. So I did this experiment. Yes, and in order to do that, I had to build the soul, and I have to film them so the real shoes and the soul should be the same, appear in the first picture and the second, and the even more important that appear at the end, the horizon should be in the same place. And the last part is what is the actual medium of the non-stop stop motion project, which is a kind of question. It appears quite often in film festivals, in galleries, and so on. And I would say it's a kind of expanded cinema, or no, meta cinema, which you like the term, you use it today a lot. And it could be kind of any media that reflect the medium of film in different levels, I would say. So it's fine what it is, it's okay. And why I do everything? I mean, to examine the magic trick of cinematography and mysteries of expression, which is very interesting. But even more important is to trigger unexpected narrative. So this is the trying, then you see what is happening, and then you redefine the story, or the story happens from itself. So I wanted to dance with a creature made of so many people, and at the end then disappeared. So somehow it builds its own narratives, this kind of method. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.